So if you're learning the theory of smooth manifolds for the first time, you may be kind of overwhelmed by these things that people are always talking about, particularly the tensor product, the exterior product, the symmetric product, all these kind of operations that we do on vector spaces. So, I mean, these concepts are really the kind of thing that once you learn them, you're just so frustrated with the fact that there are people out there who don't understand them, and you're just like, I mean, this is just literally the most natural thing in the world. I mean, everybody should understand this. So let me just kind of talk about how these things cropped up. Okay, so in linear algebra, you have linear operators, right? You have linear maps between vector spaces. You have vectors. You have linear functionals, okay, so elements of the dual space. If you're one of those people who had a really hard time with dual spaces and double dual spaces and all that kind of stuff, I mean, all I can say is you're going to have a hell of a time with tensor products, because all of tensor products, exterior algebras, exterior powers, differential forms, all these things, they're all based on this very simple fact from that you'll see in any advanced course on linear algebra, and namely, it's this fact, that if we have a finite dimensional vector space, V, then there's a natural isomorphism between V and V star star. Okay, so let me just remind you, if we have a vector space V, so if V is a vector space, right, then you're probably pretty familiar with the fact that if I give you a linear map from the underlying field into V, it's the same thing as a vector, right? So obviously V is naturally isomorphic to the set of linear maps, so we'll say K linear maps from K into V, where K is your field, okay? So in a sense then, it seems pretty natural to just swap the arguments of this Hom functor and call that the dual space of V. So we get another vector space, and that's denoted V star, and it's defined to be the set of K linear maps from V to K this time, instead of from K to V, okay? So, in other words, these are phi, is it too low? No, I'm good. So they're linear maps phi from V to K, okay? So people have come up with a whole host of names for the elements of this derived vector space, the dual space. These phi are called variously covectors, linear functionals. Some older books will even call them linear functions, because they say, oh, if you have a vector space here and not just a field, you should call that a linear mapping or something like that. But anyway, so that's what the dual space is, okay? So this is the dual space of V. Okay? And so it's very natural to ask, are we getting anything new here? If I have a vector space and I take its dual space, is that a new vector space? And for the rest of this talk, I'm going to be assuming that everything's finite dimensional. So infinite dimensional vector spaces, topological vector spaces, all that stuff, I don't care about. I'm assuming everything is algebraic here. Okay? So turns out that in the case that V is finite dimensional, there's a sense in which you're not getting anything new, because every vector space is determined by its dimension, okay, completely. That's all the information that's there, okay? But at the same time, it kind of is something different to V, because we have no natural way of identifying vectors, elements of V, with covectors, elements of V star, okay? So when you have extra structure on your vector space, so if you have a non-degenerate bilinear form, an inner product, then of course you do have a natural way of identifying V with V star. But in general, we should really make a distinction, because again, we have no natural identification between V and V star, okay? But anyway, we have this dual space, and I guess in finite dimensional linear algebra, one of the really useful facts about the dual space is that if you have a basis for V, okay, then you get a basis for V star. How does that work? Well, let me just, so have some space over here. So if I have a basis, which I'll denote what should I, let's just say e lower 1 through e lower n, and that's that is a basis for V, then letting e upper j, okay, I'm going to define e upper j to be an element of the dual space of V now. How do I do it? I just say that, okay, well, I can give a linear map from V to K just by telling you how it acts on a basis for V, right? Everybody knows this. You can extend any function on a basis to a linear map on the vector space, right? So if I just say, okay, Ej of Ei is going to be the Kronecker delta Ji, okay? So what's the Kronecker delta? Well, when these two indices I and j match, when they're equal, it's 1. Otherwise, it's 0. Okay, so this thing is 1 if I equals j, right? And 0 otherwise. Okay, so if I make this definition, then this subset, okay, e1, e upper 1 up to e upper n, that is a subset now of the dual of V. Hopefully that's still in the frame, yep. Okay, so this subset is called the dual basis. The dual basis for V star. Okay? So this is very important because it tells us that when we fix coordinates, it's going to translate to the fact that when we fix coordinates locally on a manifold, we can express tensors locally in terms of a basis, but then we also have, you know, a basis that naturally goes along with it for the dual space. Because what a tensor is going to be, I'll kind of motivate this better in a second, but what it's going to be is it's just going to be a bunch of vectors kind of, you know, tacked onto a bunch of covectors, and then in general, what this thing is going to do is it's going to eat a bunch of vectors, and then it's going to eat a bunch of covectors, and then it's going to give you an element of the field, a scalar, okay? So surprisingly enough, practically every object that comes up in linear algebra is of this form. It just eats a bunch of vectors, it eats a bunch of functionals, or covectors, whatever you want to call them, and then it spits out an element of the field. Everything is like that. Vectors, covectors, linear maps, bilinear forms, you know, whatever. All the crazy stuff that comes up in differential geometry, they're all just tensors of some kind, right? So this is what the dual space is, okay? And now I just want to briefly review this natural isomorphism. Okay, so how does this guy work? All right, so I want to define a map from V to the space of linear functionals on the dual of V, okay? So in other words, this thing, the double dual, all right? So how do I do this? I just define theta sub V from V to V star star by, well, theta sub V of, so this is, I should be careful here, okay? This is a map that I'm subscripting by the vector space, and there's a very good reason for that. That's because these maps will turn out to be the components of a natural transformation from the identity functor to the double dual functor. If you don't know what that means, it doesn't matter. It's just some category theoretic crap garbage. So if you apply eta sub v to a vector v, okay, that needs to be an element of this space. But this space is defined to be the space of functionals on v star. Okay. So in other words, this thing, okay, needs to be a linear map from V star into K, right? That's what the elements of V star star are. So how do I define it? I just take a phi, okay, a functional on V, and I just send him to phi of V. All right? So this is the way you get this identification. And again, I'm assuming the dimensions are finite here. V is finite dimensional. And it's very easy, it's a fairly easy exercise, which, I mean, everybody should know how to do or attempt once in their life, that eta sub V is an isomorphism. And you're going to need the finite dimensionality to prove this, because it's not true in infinite dimensions. Okay? So there's a very, very nice linear algebra exercise. Prove that this is an isomorphism. All right, so what's really going on behind the covers here is really just the fact that you have a very natural pairing between a vector space and its dual. All right? So then, to get this isomorphism, all you do is you just put a vector into the first slot of that pairing. And that gives you a thing that's still waiting for a functional on V before it gives you a scalar. Okay? So my argument is that whenever you're confused about tensor products or exterior products, or you're confused about how a connection on a vector bundle gives you induced connections on these derived bundles, like the dual bundle and the tensor bundle and blah, 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 all you ever have to do is just go back to this situation, think of linear algebra, and just say, okay, what's the most natural thing I could do here? And there will always only be one thing that makes sense. Everything else will just seem artificial, okay? So if you go back to this idea all the time, and you just always think of this natural pairing, okay, so what's the pairing I'm talking about? And when I write this down, trust me, you'll agree with me, this is literally the most natural thing in the world, okay? So you have a pairing that takes in a vector, and it takes in a functional, and what does it do? It just evaluates that vector at that functional, right? So it just takes in a V, and it takes in a linear functional on V, and it says, okay, I'm just going to give you phi of V. It's the most natural thing in the world. It's practically just falls right out of the dual space, right? So this pairing, just always think about this, and just always think about, okay. So let me denote this. Okay, so I'm going to define angle bracket V phi to V phi of V, okay? So then the isomorphism between V and its double dual is just this. I just take V and I just send it to this, okay? Now this thing is a function from V star to K. In other words, it's a linear function from V star to K. In other words, it's an element of V star star. That's exactly what the natural isomorphism is, okay? So, or you might write this like this, as I kind of did before. Right, where it's understood that this thing in the brackets, I'm giving you a function. That's what the image of this is, okay? So, always just go back to this pairing, and it'll make everything clear. Alright, so, I was talking about geometry before. When you start learning geometry, you run into a kind of technical obstacle, because there are certain quantities in geometry that are very natural and that you'd expect people to study. You'd expect people to study vector fields on manifolds. You'd expect people to study functions on manifolds, smooth functions on manifolds. You'd expect them to study, whatever they need to integrate, whatever kind of object is the correct object to integrate on a manifold, right? That's something you want to do. Turns out that densities, not functions, are the correct thing to integrate, but you can see that later. So I really want to talk about the tensor product of vector spaces. Okay, so this is the thing that people write as V tensor W. All right. So if you go to Google right now or Wikipedia or whatever, and you type in tensor product and you look at the definition, chances are it won't make any sense to you, unless you're already a very mature mathematician. But chances are you'll be like, what's going on? Why are they doing all this weird stuff where they take V cross W, they take the free vector space on that, and they start identifying all these elements and quotienting out by this subspace and whatever. So, that's the formal construction of the tensor product, and you need to do that in general, because in general, so here's a secret. If V and W are both finite dimensional, I can get away with something kind of evil. I can say, okay, V tensor W is just going to be the space of bilinear maps from V star cross W star over to the field. And that actually works. But it works for a kind of evil reason. And What I should really say is that, in general, for V and W, you know, possibly infinite dimensional spaces, their tensor product is the space of finite rank bilinear operators. And I don't even know if that's enough. Yeah, I think there's a dual condition that I need there. I don't just need the image to be finite dimensional, but I also need, I don't know, maybe it just follows. But anyway, so yeah, you can define it as a certain subspace of the bilinear forms, right? But the issue is, in general, it's good to have a construction that doesn't rely on that, and that makes it easier for us to prove the properties that are important about the tensor product, okay? So let me start from the beginning and just tell you. In linear algebra, you learn about vectors, functionals, linear maps, okay? But then some evil person comes along and says, oh, but here's an inner product. We're gonna throw bilinear forms at you now. And you know, we're gonna start thinking about a bilinear mapping from V cross W into some other vector space U. You know, what's that? And you're like, oh, this seems like something I've never dealt with before. Do I have to develop a whole new branch of math to deal with these objects? Is there a multilinear algebra now that I have to spend another, you know, however many months studying? Well, fortunately, the answer is no. So this is an example of a situation that comes up a lot in mathematics, where you're studying some class of object, and then you go and study some other type of object, and you're like, that seems complicated, you know, why are we doing this? It's getting too complicated, there's too many definitions and stuff. And you think you have to go and start from scratch again, but the truth is that if you're clever, you can recognize that that concept, which a priori seemed more general, is actually just an incarnation of a familiar concept applied to some case, okay? So all this to say, the tensor product is just a thing which allows us to realize multilinear mappings, multilinear algebra, as a special case, in some sense, of linear algebra, okay? So the reason the tensor product exists is because it's a space whose vectors are kind of like the minimal kind of object that a bilinear form operates on, okay? So let's think about what a multilinear function does, right? So you have this function f, and it's multilinear if whenever I have f of x1 through to, you know, lambda xi plus yi, and then I got all the way down to xn, right? Whenever I have this, I want this thing to be equal to, well, I can pull the lambda out, x1 all the way down to xi, all the way down to xn, and then I have plus f x1, well actually let's call this xi prime, all the way down to xn, okay? So this is the definition of multilinearity. So of course here, this is a scalar, all these guys are vectors, okay? All the xi's and xi primes are vectors, okay? So this is what multilinearity means. But the tensor product is going to be a vector space such that whenever I have, you know, let's just for simplicity, let's say it's bilinear, not, you know, nine linear or whatever. Whenever I have a bilinear mapping from V cross W into some other vector space, I can somehow, there's no more data contained in that bilinear mapping than there is in some linear mapping from a special space that's derived from V and W into wherever, right? So that's what the tensor product is, okay? It's that simple. You can forget about all these weird constructions you've seen and weird kind of explanations and stuff about bases and dimensions multiplying and all this, these other reasons people use to try to explain it. This is the reason the tensor product exists, okay? So formally, in diagrams, the tensor product is a thing that does this. So again, we'll stick to the case of bilinear stuff, okay? So, you know, V cross W, I have some bilinear map into, this is another vector space, Z, okay? So I got an F and this guy's bilinear. All right, this is what the tensor product does. You have a very natural bilinear map, okay, which people denote by an infix tensor product symbol like this. And it goes over to some other space, okay, this mysterious space, and this guy has the property that any other bilinear map F here, okay, there's one of these guys, there are lots of those guys, okay, so any other bilinear map F induces a unique linear map, F squiggle. Okay? So hopefully this makes it very clear. The tensor product, which is this question mark here, is a thing that reduces multilinear algebra to linear algebra. Okay? So what goes in this question mark? It's just V tensor W. Right? That's the tensor product of V and W. Okay, so in general, you know, you give me any multilinear, so if you give me any number, right, say like 9 or something, I can look at 9 linear maps from this giant product of 9 vector spaces into Z, and there's going to be another thing down here, which people usually write as V1 tensored with V9, you know, you just tensor all these guys together. This guy is going to linearize 9 linear maps from this giant product into Z, okay? And notice that Z, you know, I can change Z. There's only one of these guys. There's one tensor product, and it works for all bilinear maps, no matter where they're mapping you into, okay? All right, so this diagram here is what people call the universal property, the tensor product. And if there's one thing that you should remember about tensor products, it's this, okay? Forget about all the other symbol-pushing crap you've read, okay? This is what matters. Okay, so that's the tensor product, and there's a similar explanation for the exterior product. So you've probably seen things like, you've probably seen this thing. Okay, this is the kth exterior power of V, or you may have seen the full exterior algebra of V, which is just, I mean, you only have to go up to the nth because they vanish after that. It's just the direct sum of all these graded. So it's a graded algebra, and its grades are just these exterior powers. Okay, and there's a multiplication on this thing, which is the wedge product, and this space. You can build it from any vector space. You get one of these algebras and you get these vector spaces and so on. And this space is what's used to formalize integration on manifolds. Okay, so you need to talk about this to make sense of what a differential form is. And a differential form is kind of like, it's a thing that lets you measure, you know, infinitesimal, so it lets you measure volumes of infinitesimal k-dimensional parallelepipeds. At a point on a manifold. That's the reason you talk about them. And the reason you use this kind of skew commutative alternating wedge product is because you need to keep track of the orientation of things. Okay, so if I integrate a function from A to B, that's negative the integral from B to A. And if I integrate over a square by doing, you know, this first, then that's negative integrating a square by, you know, going the other way first. So that's kind of why those show up. So what is the answer, what is that structure answering? Okay, so this is what I'm trying to get at. Like, all of these constructions that appear in multilinear algebra are all just answers to some very natural question. They're all just solutions to some universal problem, okay? So for the tensor product, okay, so V tensor W linearizes bilinear maps out of V cross W. Okay, that's what it does. What else do we have? We have the tensor algebra of V. That's the direct sum, and now you have to actually go all the way up to infinity of the tensor powers of V. So you might write those as V tensor, and then you put a K up here to tell you that you're tensoring V with itself k times. Okay, so you take a direct sum of all those guys. This thing is called the tensor algebra of V. And what's this thing doing? Well, in some sense, tensor algebra is the most general associative algebra, okay, into which V embeds. So, and it's not commutative. Okay, so this is the most general associative algebra on V. Okay? And then you have some other things, like you have the exterior algebra of V. And this is universal in the sense that every linear map out of V into an associative algebra with the property that if you take the square of the image of any vector, you get zero, will factor through this. Okay? So I'll kind of talk a bit more about that after. But I really want to get you used to the whole calculus of tensors, all right? So how do we work with these things? So as a first example, linear maps, okay? So what I want to try to convey to you is that all these things are just tensors, linear maps, vectors, functionals, bilinear forms, whatever, you know, they're all just tensors of different types. So a vector, okay, that's just an element of V, right? So that's an element of a giant tensor product where you have one V factor and zero V star factors, okay? And similarly, a covector or linear functional, that's an element of V star, all right? What about a linear map? So linear map, or linear operator on V, okay? Let's say it's an endomorphism of V. Well, those belong to a vector space most people don't know like this, or maybe the K here to remind you that we're viewing it as a K vector space, okay? This space, I mean, by definition, is the space of linear maps from V to V, okay? Now here's where the tensor product comes in, because it turns out, so exercise, and I'll kind of tell you how to do it. The exercise is that if I take the space of linear maps from one vector space to another, all right, this is naturally isomorphic to V star tensor W. So you're like, why is there a star there? The reason there's a star there, the way you should think about it, is that if you give me an element of this tensor product, it's kind of waiting for a vector of V. Okay, and then once it gets a vector of V, this guy will absorb it. So you can feed the vector of V to this covector, okay, because that's what covectors do. They eat vectors and they spit out scalars. Okay, so that's why this, kind of roughly speaking, why this is true. And whenever you see a star, it's telling you, I'm waiting for something of that from that space. Meanwhile, this W is just kind of coming along for the ride, right? So why is this true? Well, it basically goes something like this. Let's say you give me an element of V star tensor W, right? Then in general, it's going to be a big sum of pure tensors. So a pure tensor is something that looks like this. It's just you have a functional on V tensored with a vector of W. Now you're like, wait a minute, isn't everything of that form? No, they're not all of that form. Okay, the reason they're not all of that form is because if they were, that space would just be the Cartesian product of V star and W, right? But it's not, it's the tensor product. Okay, the dimension of the Cartesian product of two vector spaces is the sum of the dimensions. But what this thing does for us is its dimension is the product of the dimensions. Okay, so in general, there's a sum here, and then I have to have, you know, I have to have a sum over I. Looks like this. But let's just say we're given a pure one. Okay, so it is actually just the tensor product of a covector with a vector, right? Where do I send this guy? What linear map does this represent? Okay, he's a functional on V. That's a vector on, that's a vector in W. Okay, I want a linear map from V to W. Okay, so if you come along and you give me V, a vector in V, what do I do? What's the most obvious thing I can do here? I just take the V and I feed it to phi. Okay, and that gives me a scalar. Okay, I'm just going to scale W by that amount, right? So this thing, well, maybe I should write it over here, phi tensor W. To establish this isomorphism, all you do is you basically, you just send this guy over to the linear map that takes a vector V in V and spits out phi of V, scalar multiplication with W. Okay, that's all it is. Now you're like, I mean, how do I know, you know, you just finished telling me that not everything in here is of this form. Why is that enough to give me a linear map like this? Well, that's what the universal property of the tensor product does for you, okay? So if you look back at that, you say, okay, well, I mean, if I want to be pedantic, if I want to be completely precise, what I'm doing is I'm defining a bilinear map from V star cross W from the Cartesian product into this vector space, okay? And then, I have to check that it's bilinear, but then once I've done that, I just say, oh, well, this is exactly what the tensor product does. Whenever I have a bilinear map like that, it gives me, you know, it gives me a linear factorization. So that's this linear map, okay? This is a linear isomorphism. Okay, so precisely, define map V star cross W into, well, VW, right? So I define this and check that it's bilinear. Apply universal property. Of the tensor product, and then you're done. So is that, yeah, just on the frame. Okay, good. So that's how this this isomorphism works. Okay. So we wanted to talk about linear operators on V, right? Endomorphisms. Those are in this space. So by this exercise, this is just the same space. I mean, naturally identified with V star tensor V, okay? So you see the pattern that's developing here. Here I just had a V, here I just had a V star. Now I kind of got both of them going on. I got one that's a V star and one that's a V, right? So this motivates as far as I care to motivate. I mean, you're a mathematician, what more motivation do you need, right? So, I mean, these guys are gonna end up being called, I can't remember what the usual convention is. It's 0, 1, this is 1, 0, and these guys are 1, 1, okay? So, in general, I can define tensors of type RS, okay? And what it's going to be is it's going to have R V star factors. It's going to be an element of a tensor space where you have R V star factors and S V factors, okay? But the elements of that space are just things that are waiting for R vectors, and then they spit out S vectors, or I guess to be more correct, I should say, they're waiting for R vectors and S covectors before they give you a number, okay? So that's the intuition you should have for this stuff. You should always think about elements of tensor spaces as just being things that are waiting to be fed enough crap before they give you numbers, okay? That's what they all are. Okay, so I'm going to erase this exercise now because I want to continue listing special cases of this, all right? So what might a type 2,0 tensor be? Okay, so this one is going to be an element of, so maybe I should divide this up. All right, so nothing I can do about that. Okay. these objects. So they're type 2,0, okay, which means they're going to live, they're going to be elements of that space. Okay, now I have two dual factors. So what that means is I'm waiting for two vectors, and then I give you a scalar. Okay, so what are those? Well, they're just bilinear forms. So now we're seeing a lot of the objects from linear algebra subsumed by this general construction. Okay, but you're probably still unconvinced. You know, this doesn't motivate it for me. Why do we have to talk about type RS tensors? I mean, nobody cares about anything other than, you know, these objects in linear algebra. Well, that's actually not true. For example, the Lie bracket of a Lie algebra, it's not a bilinear form. It's actually, I mean, it won't give you a scalar once you give it two vectors. It'll give you another vector, right? Same thing with the cross product, right? Think about the cross product from linear algebra. You give it two vectors, and it gives you another vector, okay? So it's not of this type. It's of type 2, 1, okay? So, but you're probably still thinking, oh, well, so what? I mean, you've unified a few things, but what have you really accomplished? Well, you have a point. If I'm only interested in doing linear algebra, there's a sense in which this is kind of useless. I mean, until you start talking about things like representation theory. But if you're just interested in pure linear algebra, it doesn't really matter. But the reason we do this, from a geometric perspective, is because, unfortunately, geometers don't just study vector fields and functions and differential forms and stuff. They actually study the concept of curvature. They study, you know, how much a space fails to be flat, okay? And once you start getting into that stuff, you have to define these weirder types of objects. There's something called the Riemann curvature tensor, the Ricci tensor, scalar curvatures, all this stuff. And I mean, that's not even mentioning the kind of stuff that comes up when you get into complex geometry and all this stuff. And you have to talk, I mean, people talk about connections on vector bundles, and anyway, everything really starts to invoke the full power of these constructions. So you really need type RS tensors in general, and you need even more fancier things than that, okay? So, for example, the Riemann curvature tensor, one version of it is a type 3,1 tensor, which means that you give it three vector fields and it spits out another vector field, okay? And then when you take some contractions of it, you get like a 4,0 tensor and some other stuff. So these constructions are very useful in their full generality, okay? And then you have representation theory where, I mean, if you have a group that's acting on a vector space, then it also acts on tensor powers and exterior powers and all these other things attached to that vector space. And you can relate that to projective geometry and all kinds of exciting things. So that's pretty much the tensor product for you. So hopefully it's very clear now. I actually haven't even defined what the tensor product is. I mean, I kind of told you at the start, okay, I can cheat and define it as a space of bilinear forms, but if you really want to get a formal definition of the tensor product from a pure math perspective, you have to talk about free vector spaces, and then you have to take this quotient, then you have to show that, you know, this object you get at the end, I mean, the construction's mad. I mean, if you think about what you're actually doing, you have these two vector spaces, you take their Cartesian product, okay, and then you take the free vector space on that set, okay? So the free vector space on a set is a vector space which in some sense has the elements of that set as its basis, all right? So if I take a Cartesian product of, like, two vector spaces, I mean, say they're both like R2 or something. I take R4 and I take a vector space whose basis is R4. Like, that's a huge vector space, right? Its dimension is uncountable. And then what I do is I take this giant thing and then I glue all these points together. So I have to glue together, I have to glue together this. This needs to be the same thing as this. And that has to be the same thing as that, and so on and so forth. And I make all these, I quotient out this giant subspace of relations, And then, you know, when all the dust clears, I'm left with an object, T, which actually satisfies the property that I mentioned before. In particular, I have this space that comes from V and W. I have this natural bilinear map. So T will actually be defined as the free vector space on V cross W mod this big subspace of relations. It's a quotient space. And then it has this effect that whenever I have a bilinear mapping F into, you know, Z or something, then I get a unique linear F squiggle. So you go through this whole construction and it's all just, you know, standard algebraic tricks, and then it turns out that this guy actually does what he's designed to do. All right. So I guess one more thing I should talk about tensors is this concept of contraction. Okay, so it's very important. There's other interesting things you can do with tensors, but we'll leave those for later. So, contraction. Sorry, just a sec. All right, so what's contraction? Contraction is when you have, you basically do what I referred to before. You kind of feed one piece of the tensor to another piece of the tensor, right? So let's just start out with an example. Okay, linear maps. So, as I talked about before, the way a linear map works is it's a thing which has one V star piece and it's then got a W piece, right? And then you feed it a V and kind of the V star and the V combine together and they go away, right? So the way contraction of linear maps works, so there's two aspects of this. Application of a linear map is a contraction, and taking the trace of a linear map is also a contraction. Okay. So first of all, if you have a linear operator, or let's just say it's a linear map. So this guy is in VW, right? Then since that space is just isomorphic to E star tensor W, if we pick a basis, if we pick bases E1, EN, and F1, FM for V and W respectively, then, as I mentioned before, this basis here for V gives us a dual basis, right? It gives us a basis for V star. Okay, so we can represent T as T equals, so I have to now sum over all the basis elements of V, a sum over all the basis elements of W. Okay, so it's this double sum. And then I have some numbers here. And I'm gonna kind of judiciously choose these indices. Let's just swap these, okay? So let's do this, and now I'm gonna have Fi. Okay, and then here I'm gonna have some numbers, some scalars, Aij, okay? So what I'm trying to get at is that when I mentioned before that not all the elements in a tensor product are pure tensors, they're not all of the form, you know, something in here, tensor, something in there. When you interpret the space of linear maps from V to W as this tensor product, you can characterize the ones that are pure tensors. Okay, what are they? Well, if it's a pure tensor, then think about the linear map that we view that as. What's its rank? Well, the way the linear map worked is that if we had something was just like this, then we just feed the vector to this functional, and then it would output this vector, right? So that means that they're rank one linear maps, okay? So the pure tensors are exactly the rank one linear maps under our natural identification. And so in general, if I have a general linear map, well, it's just the sum of a bunch of rank one linear maps, right? It's the same way you can write an arbitrary matrix as the sum of a bunch of outer products, okay? So you can decompose it like that, and so you get this. That's what a general T looks like. Okay, so I wanted to talk about contraction. So contraction is now what happens. How do I apply T, right? T of V. So the operation, the act of applying T to a vector V can be broken down into two steps, okay? The first step is you take T, which is an element of this tensor product space, and you just tack on a factor of V. Okay, you just tensor all this stuff with V, right? You just do this. I mean, that's not T anymore, that's now T tensor V, and it's living in V star tensor W tensor V, right? Once you've done that, you take these guys, and you just feed, I mean, there's at the very beginning, I said there was a natural pairing between V and V star. So you just apply that pairing, right? You got a thing in V star, you got a thing in V, you got a number, right? It just comes out. So then at the end of the day, when all the dust settles, you get exactly T of V, right? So what I'm trying to get at is that T of V is the result of taking T, tensoring it with V, and then performing a contraction on the first and third indices, okay? I mean, the order you write these down in is really meaningless, but so T of V, you can think about it as contraction of the V star factor with V, right? So that's the first example of a tensor contraction. And I mean, they all have this general idea. You have some tensor, it's got a bunch of covariant, it's got a bunch of V star factors, it's got a bunch of V factors, and then you just match up some subset of them to one another, and then you just feed them to each other. Okay. So let me talk about the trace. So that example was kind of a little bit less natural than the one I'm going to show you now, because in that example I had a linear map, and then I had to kind of bring a vector into the picture and then, you know, feed it to it. But now, let's just say I have a linear map, no vectors, nothing. So say T is inside end V, all right? So it's actually just an operator on one vector space now, and that's naturally identified with this. Alright, so now we have this object that has one covariant component and one contravariant component. Okay, they're called covariant and contravariant because when you write down the transformation laws in differential geometry, or even in linear algebra, when you change bases, the representations of these things, one of them changes with the change of basis and the other one changes against the change of basis in a certain sense. So that's why these indices are called covariant. And those ones are called contravariant. All right. So we just have this linear operator on V. Okay. Again, T is just now I can write it like this. That's down there. By the way, in geometry, you'll often see people. They're really lazy. They don't like writing sums. So they'll just drop this and they'll say, oh, T is that. And you'll be like, what's I and J? What are I and J? But so the way they do it is they agree that whenever you have an index that appears up and down in the same term, there's an implicit summation. Okay, so this would be interpreted as sum over all I and J. Okay, but they just don't write the sum. I will keep it in there though. Okay, so you have this linear map, the contraction. So if there's only one contraction we can do, I mean, if it was like V star tensor V, then I would need to decide which factor I want to contract with the extra v, right? But in this case, there's only one. So the contraction of t is, so what happens if we just do this? So I'm going to take this ei, which is just kind of coming along for the ride, and I'm just going to feed him to ej. So I get a sum over all I and j. That's still in the picture? Yeah, okay. So I get a sum over all I and j of a, I, j. And then when this guy goes in there, I just get, you know, delta j, I. So notice how the indices are all chosen so that if I wanted to use the summation convention, it would work seamlessly, right? That's the kind of beauty of all this stuff. It's very, they've thought all this stuff out very well. So if I do this, notice that now this double sum is going to collapse to a single sum, right? The term only comes up when I is equal to j, right? So now I have this. What's that? I mean, the basis was arbitrary, but it doesn't matter. It's just the trace. It's just the trace of t, right? You sum the diagonal elements of a matrix in any basis. That's the trace, and it doesn't matter which basis you picked. Okay. So there you go. The trace is an example of a contraction, a tensor contraction. It's basically the simplest example there is. And so when you see things like the Riemann curvature tensor in differential geometry, you'll see that certain pairs of indices are symmetric or anti-symmetric. So you can swap them around and there are some symmetries. And so they're not all independent, that's what I'm trying to say. And so the Riemann curvature tensor actually only has really one non-trivial contraction. So there's only one thing you can do to get a lower type tensor, which won't just give you zero, okay? And so when you make that contraction, that's where the Ricci tensor comes in. That's where it comes from, okay? So the Ricci tensor is a thing that comes from the Riemann curvature tensor. You're discarding some information because you're tracing, you're taking a trace, you're doing a contraction, but it's still very useful. There's still a lot of things you can do with it. And then, of course, if you keep taking contractions, then you get all the way down to the scalar curvature. Okay. So that's what contraction is. And so, last but not least, what can we do? So I said that a non-degenerate bilinear form on V, i.e. a map, which I'll denote by these angle brackets, that takes V cross V and goes into the underlying field, such that this map is injective. Okay, you've probably seen the condition of non-degeneracy phrased slightly differently, but this is equivalent, right? So if you have a non-degenerate bilinear form on V, such that this map, which goes from V to V star, is injective, then it sets up an identification, or an isomorphism, a natural isomorphism, between V and V star. All right? So in the presence of a non-degenerate bilinear form, or an inner product, V and V star, we can identify them. So all of a sudden, bilinear forms on V, by picking one of the factors, we can convert it into a linear map, right? And I mean, this is kind of familiar because you're very used to bilinear forms being represented by, you know, square matrices. And then we say, oh, you know, if that matrix is invertible, then your form is non-degenerate, and blah, 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 blah. And so we have all these things about matrices. We identify them with bilinear forms. But the reason we can do that is because of the inner product. standard inner product on Rn or on Cn or on whatever. That's what allows us to do that. Okay, so this is linear algebra, but then you'll see when you learn Riemannian geometry, so in Riemannian geometry, you have a manifold, and then you have a Riemannian metric on the manifold. So what a Riemannian metric is it's a smoothly varying choice of inner product on all your tangent spaces. And the way you make that precise is you say, okay, well, I know what the tangent bundle of the manifold is, and I know that when I have a vector bundle, I can take dual bundles, I can take tensor powers of that bundle, whatever. And so you can define what's called a fiber metric as a section of, you know, the tensor bundle of the dual bundle of the tangent bundle, also known as the cotangent bundle, with itself. Okay, so you define a Riemannian metric to be a section of this vector bundle that satisfies some properties that encode, you know, symmetry and the fact that it's positive definite, unless you're doing GR, and then you might want it to not be positive definite. And that's what a metric is. And then this, which is just linear algebra, happens at every point of your manifold. So at every point of your manifold, you can now identify tangent vectors with cotangent vectors, otherwise known as one forms. Although one forms usually refer to the actual, you know, the thing that's defined on the whole manifold. So there's this term in Riemannian geometry, which is pretty funny, and it's called the concept of musical isomorphism. And this sounds very fancy, but all it is it's the globalization of this, all right? So the reason they call it musical isomorphism involves sharps and flats, as they call them, is because in music notation, when you put a sharp, you're raising something, and when you put a flat, you're lowering something, okay? The pitch. So the reason it's called a musical isomorphism is because it allows you to take indices of tensors and move them up or down, however you like. So indices of vectors are down. The actual vectors themselves are down. The coefficients usually go up to go along with the summation convention. And the indices of covectors are up, right? But then using the musical isomorphisms, you can raise and lower tensor indices, okay? So that's another operation you can perform on tensors. So I've talked about contraction, talked about musical isomorphism. There's some more machinery in differential geometry. You can talk about covariant derivatives and Lie derivatives, and then you can talk about exterior derivatives of forms. But as long as you understand the linear algebra, okay, as long as you understand what the tensor product does, why it exists, okay, it exists to linearize multilinear phenomena. Why the exterior product and the exterior algebra exists, okay, that exists as a kind of universal solution for, I guess, some kind of skew symmetric algebra that's on V, right? And then finally, there's a last thing called the symmetric power and the symmetric algebra. And again, like the tensor product, it's infinite dimensional, even when V is finite dimensional. And the symmetric powers are important because those give you something that's like a polynomial on V, right? So when you learn polynomials, everything's commutative, right? X, Y, Y, X, it doesn't matter which order the variables are in. So they're all commuting. And that's kind of exactly what the symmetric powers do, okay? So if I take an n-dimensional vector space, and then I look at the kth symmetric power of that, then I can take a basis for the vector space, and I'll have, you know, n things. And then the kth symmetric power is basically just like k-fold products of those things. That's the basis for the symmetric power. You take k-fold products of the basis for the vector space, right? And the order doesn't matter, so that the variables are commuting, right? And then the reason this is cool is because just as V star gives you a concept of a linear functional on a vector space, if I take the second symmetric power of V star, then now I'm kind of talking about like quadratic functions on the vector space, right? And then higher powers, you're just getting those degree polynomials. And if I take the symmetric algebra on V star, then that's just a polynomial algebra on V. So that's the algebra of all polynomial functions defined on V, okay? And again, it all just comes back down to this simple idea that, you know, when you have some V stars lying around, you should feed V's to them. And when you have V's lying around, you should feed some V stars to them. And so everything is just about things that are eating other things. That's all tensor algebra is. So tensors are the most general, and then exterior algebra deals with an anti-commuting product. So V wedge W will be negative W wedge V, and then that gives you an interesting structure as well. So those are used to talk about differential forms. So those are what you want to integrate on manifolds, or on oriented manifolds, I guess. And then they also come up a lot in representation theory. So you can take exterior powers of certain representations. So if I have a group, there's often a very natural representation of that group that's associated to it, right? So like, I don't know, SO3, that has an obvious representation on R3. And then I can be like, what about the tensor powers of that representation? What about the exterior powers of that representation? And then it turns out that often just applying these constructions, tensoring things and taking exterior powers, could actually get representatives for every isomorphism class of finite dimensional representation of that group. So, I mean, that doesn't always work, but there are lots of cases where that's enough. So that's kind of cool. It's like, you know, I don't have to do anything really magical to get all the representations. I just take the obvious one, and I just apply this multilinear algebra construction to it, and then I get all these other representations, and that's it. There's no more. Right, so that's kind of cool. Where else? Tensors also come up in quantum information theory. So a quantum state is usually modeled as an element of projective complex Hilbert space. In other words, it's a unit vector of the Hilbert space up to a global phase. So you're quotienting out by a U1 action, okay? And that's the same thing as just taking an element of projective space. And so when you have a classical system, if you have two classical systems, then if you want to describe, you know, both of them at once, the joint system, you can just take the Cartesian product of their state spaces. But then in quantum mechanics, you have entanglement, right? So I mentioned before, not every element of the tensor product is a pure tensor, okay? In quantum mechanics, that's interpreted as not every state of the joint system being a simple product of states of the individual systems, okay? You could have some kind of superposition going on, some kind of entanglement. And so that's what that, you know, that's why they need a bigger space. It's because they have things that are, you know, sums of pure tensors instead of just pure tensors, okay? So a lot of people I've talked to have come up to me and they've told me things like, oh, I have a kind of cursory understanding of tensors, but I've never learned them formally or properly. So hopefully this video helps with that, and hopefully at least I've given you a lot of intuition and motivation for how to work with these things and how to calculate with them. And now, if you really want, you can go back to Wikipedia and you can read the formal definition they give using the free vector space and all that stuff. And hopefully it'll make a lot of sense now. Thanks.